Sunday of our sermon series on Elisha, the miracle prophet. And I'm going to invite you to open your bulletin. You'll see your sermon notes printed for you. You have a couple pictures and a map and some of our scriptures and main points that we'll be going over. And so you can follow along with our message right there. You'll also see there's a place for you to take notes and write down anything you'd like to remember and take with you. If you open that flap on up, you'll see our prayer and study guide and our daily scripture readings and devotions. And I hope that you will take these with you and spend some time each day reading the devotions, reading the scripture, and talking, listening to God in prayer. That's just one of the greatest ways that we can grow in our relationship with God and be open to the way that God will lead us to serve in ministry or how God might work through our lives. So we're going to talk about Elisha today. And my purpose and goal of this message is really to help you grow in your faith. That's my hope. And when you come to church today, cold star, so you know, you're going to leave here in another however many minutes or hour or so. Yeah, we'll see how long we're here. But anyway, I want you to go out feeling the strength and the presence of the Holy Spirit in your life and like you've grown closer to God and in your commitment to God. So anyway, there's Elijah and there's Elisha. We just spent 4 weeks talking about Elijah, and he is the older one, right? Elisha is the younger one. I'll try not to get my tongue twisted saying both of their names. But I want to tell you a little bit about Elisha. Scripture calls him Elisha, son of Shaphat, of Abel-Meholah. And I'm giving you a map today. This is kind of a map that shows a lot of territory. And if you'll remember last week, when we were talking about Elijah, and he was on Mount Horeb, which is also called Mount Sinai. You see that at the very bottom of your map on the Sinai Peninsula. This is where Moses received the Ten Commandments, and it's where Elijah, you know, hears God's still small voice. And what does God tell Elijah when he's all depressed, ready to quit being a prophet, and just says, kill me now, God, right? Well, God sends him to go and anoint a couple of kings, but he also sends him to go and find Elisha and to anoint him to be the next prophet of the Lord. And so you can see that Elijah had run just as far away as he could down to the south. And now he's going to have to journey back north. You can kind of see between the two bodies of water, the Sea of Galilee in the north and the Dead Sea, very small on your map, and then the Jordan River runs between them. And you can see Abel-Meholah right there kind of in the middle. This is where Elisha lives, and this is where Elijah journeys to go and find him. This takes place in the 9th century B.C. at a time where, just like under Elijah, people have been worshiping the false god of Baal. And so he goes on up there to go and find Elisha. Now I want to kind of read our scripture to you, and then we're going to kind of break it down verse by verse. It's just three verses, though. From 1 Kings 19, verses 19 to 21. So Elijah went from there and found Elisha, son of Shaphat. He was plowing with 12 yoke of oxen, and he himself was driving the 12th pair. Elijah went up to him and threw his mantle around him. Elisha then left his oxen and ran after Elijah. Let me kiss my father and mother goodbye, he said, and then I will follow you. Go back, Elijah replied. What have I done to you? So Elisha left him and went back. He took his yoke of oxen and slaughtered them. He burned the plowing equipment to cook the meat and gave it to the people, and they ate. Then he set out to follow Elijah and became his servant. So, interesting thing about Elisha is that other than Jesus, he's going to perform more miracles than anyone else in the Bible. And another really interesting thing about him is that he's really just a very ordinary person. He's not the son of a priest. He's not a monk. He's not just some spiritual giant necessarily. He's a humble man who's working on the family farm. But he's someone that God goes and calls to do extraordinary things. I want to just kind of give you a little roadmap of where we're headed for the next several weeks. Next Sunday, we're going to look at this story. It's kind of cool. There are these kings, three kings, and they want to go take on this other king. And they've got their troops out marching around, but there's been no rain, and there's no water for their troops or for their livestock. And so they go to Elisha, the miracle prophet, and they ask him, hey, pray for rain for us. And what he tells them is he says, no, I will, but I want you to go and dig ditches first. Dig ditches in every valley, places that catch the water when God sends the rain. And so that's what we're going to talk about next week. Then the third week, we're going to talk about a widow. She's at her wit's end. She has almost nothing, and she's in debt, and they're going to come and take away her two sons, and all she has is a little bit of oil, and she thinks it's not enough. And Elisha is going to pray with her and basically to show her that God's given her everything that she needs, and God will provide for her in a way that will actually give her everything that she needs, even financially, to survive at that time. The fourth week, we're going to look at there's a foreigner named Naaman, and he has leprosy, and he's a military guy, and he comes seeking healing from Elisha. And we're going to talk about the healing he receives, and we're going to do some anointing with oil to offer healing to anything that causes the greatest pain in your life in that fourth week. And then on the fifth week, we're going to look at another miracle story. Basically, some of the students who are going to, the seminary students who are going to become prophets, they are all working to build kind of a new sanctuary. And they're chopping away at this axe head, which would have been very valuable. It goes flying off into a body of water, and it sinks. And Elisha, the prophet, comes, and he throws a stick of wood into the water, and it makes the axe head float. And symbolically, what we're going to do in that message is we're going to talk about how we sometimes lose our spiritual edge. How can you find what you've lost? How can you keep your spiritual edge back? So that's kind of where we're headed during this sermon series. And, you know, you've maybe heard more about Elijah than Elisha, but boy, I think you're going to be blessed. And I hope that this whole series is something that will bless you and help you to grow in your relationship with God. Well, let's take a closer look at verse 19. It's there in your sermon notes. Elijah was plowing the 12 yoke of oxen, and he himself was driving the 12th pair. So I do want to kind of point out, he's running the family farm, and if he's got 12 yoke of oxen, that tells us something about Elisha. It tells us that the family farm is a rather large operation at that day. And so he comes from a family with some amount of means. I just kind of mentioned that, but that being said, I want you to notice that he's doing the same job that he's probably been doing for a long time. And he's working on his parents' farm, and he's driving this yoke of oxen, plowing. Any of you grow up on a farm? Anyone? Farming families? Anything at all? I know we have a few in the church, but okay. I know my dad spent a lot of time up north of Oklahoma on the back of on a tractor plowing fields. And maybe anybody ever mow their yard? It's kind of the same thing. You go back and forth in lines, right? And it can be, it can give you a lot of time to think, but it can be somewhat monotonous. And I want you to kind of think about it. He's driving these oxen, they're plowing the field. What does he see? What does he smell? What's your scenery every day as you're driving this oxen behind the plow? And I'll give you a picture here, a man doing this. And farming is wonderful work, but I will say that just like anything, it could become monotonous, because what do you see every day? Well, you see oxen rears, oxen tails, oxen behinds, so that's kind of going on. And now some of you may feel a little bit like Elijah, maybe now or maybe during certain periods of your life, and you're going to the same job, you're working with the same people, you're doing the same thing, and maybe you feel sometimes like you're staring at oxen rears. Now, don't go and call your co-workers oxen rears, that's not what I'm trying to get you to do, but some of you may be in sales, and it's day in and day out, you have a quota that you have to meet, and so you work really hard at it, but you feel like this is so monotonous, all I ever do is try to live up to a standard, and then it starts over again the next week. Some of you, might be students, and you're in college or you're in high school, and you're like, what do I do? Well, I go to class and I study and I pull all-nighters and I write papers and then I have tests and I get through one semester and then another one starts. And it can be very monotonous. Or those of you who are parents, what do you see all day long? Maybe you see diapers and laundry and dishes and diapers and laundry and dishes, and you have a hard time getting things done by the end of this week, and then the next week starts. And if you've got little children, maybe what you see a lot of is baby rears every day as you're changing diaper after diaper after diaper. And this is where Elisha was, and I want you to notice that he's very faithful to the task at hand. He's serving the family. He is working hard on the farm. And I believe with all my heart that God loves to reward those who are faithful with a little. Because when you're faithful with a little, God can trust you with so much more. And even though it might not have been Elisha's favorite thing to do, or he may have really loved the farm work that he was doing. But either way, it could be incredibly draining physically and emotionally. And he remains faithful. In the middle of a faithful daily routine, God comes to someone who is very normal, very ordinary, and then calls him to some work that is extraordinary, to a place of impact. And so, back to Elijah, the older prophet. Remember, Elijah is a great man of God. And Elisha looks up to Elijah. Into verse 19, it says this: Elijah went up to him and threw his mantle around him. I love Lauren's cape that she had on, kind of like a cloak or a mantle. But I want to talk about this for a second. Symbolically, Elijah's mantle is kind of like Moses' staff. You know, many times when Elijah performs a miracle, he uses his mantle, just like Moses would with his staff. But saying a little bit more about it, his mantle would be kind of like a coat or an outer kind of shawl type of thing made up of maybe animal skin or fur, and it's his covering. And so Elijah takes his covering and he puts it on Elisha. And symbolically, he's saying, that which covered me will now cover you. That which was the mantle on me will now be the mantle on you. That which I was under, you will now be under. I will be your mentor and you will learn from me. And as God's been working through me to perform things in the name of the Lord, God's going to work through you now and guide you and use you and speak through you. And he puts his mantle over him. There's a little picture of this in your notes as well, kind of showing this process of putting his mantle on him. It's kind of a passing of the torch, even a passing of a blessing. And I want to just kind of pause for a moment and talk about the difference that a mentor can make in your life. One of the most important ways we can find meaning in our lives is to share the faith that God has given us and our experiences with God with younger generations, with the younger person. But I just find it fascinating. You know, we talked last week about Elijah being depressed. One of the ways that God blesses Elijah and pulls him out of that depression is he says, I'm going to send you to mentor a younger person. I'm going to send you to Elisha. He's going to be your partner in ministry. And you're going to share all of your wisdom with him. You're going to pour into him and bless him so that he can be a blessing to many people. And through this mentoring relationship, God blesses both Elijah and Elisha. Why? Because they both put something into it. Both of them give something to the relationship, and both of them receive the blessings of this kind of mentoring relationship. So I want to kind of talk about both sides of that. Elijah, he takes the time to share all that he's learned, all of his experiences, all of his wisdom with Elisha. He shares his mistakes, he shares his successes. And I really do believe that God values maturity. You know, there's a lot of maturity in this room. And our older generations, the best days are ahead of them if they'll invest in our younger generations, if they'll pour into our younger generations. And one of the biggest blessings that our older generations can give to younger generations is not just to delegate, you know, tasks to them. You know, oh, well, this is something we don't want to do, so I'm sure we can get the youth group to do that, right? But rather to delegate authority. What do I mean by that? I mean, inviting younger generations, whether that's children and youth or some of our younger adults, to come and be part of the decision-making of the direction of ministry that our church is headed. Because I'll tell you that if younger generations become part of that conversation, they're going to invest more in the ministry of our church. They're going to feel included. And we're called to include all of the generations in our church as we journey forward into God's future. And the other thing that happens when some authority is delegated is that, guess what? First time you get to make a decision, sometimes you get it right, sometimes you mess it up, right? We learn from our mistakes, and sometimes we even learn from our successes. But giving that opportunity to succeed or to fail is one of the ways that we can help to create a new generation of leaders in our church. And so Elijah takes the time to share his wisdom and all of his experiences with Elisha. And he helps Elisha learn from him and empowers him to do the work of a prophet. And so that happens. But Elisha, on his part, Elisha is willing to serve and follow Elijah so that he could learn from him. And he really honors Elijah. He doesn't say, God's calling me to be a prophet. I know it all, old man. Get away from me. I don't have anything going for me. No, he says, I want to learn from you, from your experiences, from your wisdom. And so Elisha honors Elijah. He He gives him value. He builds him up. He listens. And he takes that wisdom and begins to put it to work in his own life. And I can tell you that young Christians learn how to follow and serve God by many times spending time with more mature and long-standing Christians, learning how to pray, learning how to serve, learning the stories of the Bible. And it's amazing what can happen when relationships form across generations. And, you know, that's one of the neatest things to me about Mission Madness, is that it's an opportunity for you to get to know the children in our church, to get to know the youth in our church, to get to know some of the younger adults in our church, and for those generations to get to know some of the people who have helped lead or be part or serve in this church for years and years. I mean, what other institutions offer you that opportunity to be exposed and around and to know multiple generations of people? And so I'd ask you in the coming week to begin to think about, you know, the people who loved you and mentored you when you were younger. Who was it that taught you Jesus? And how did that person bless you? What lessons did they teach you? You know, you probably still hear their voice speaking in your ear. And I would also suggest that one of your biggest blessings could be getting to know some of the younger people in our church, pouring into them, fostering relationships with them. Who are you mentoring? How are you training a younger person to carry on the ministry that you've been doing for years, maybe even in a new way, an exciting new way? So that's a little bit about passing things on from generation to generation. And you know, you'll see Matt leading youth, you'll see Lauren helping to lead our children and family ministry, but they can't do it alone. Those ministries only thrive when people in our church embrace them and come alongside and help, lead, and serve. And I really believe that. Let me move on. I want to apply a couple of two principles to how this story might speak to your life. We're going to watch how this ordinary man responds to this extraordinary call. And God calls Elisha to follow Elijah, but Elisha doesn't know all of the details yet. So here's your first point I've kind of printed in your sermon notes. And it's this: you don't have to understand fully to obey immediately. You don't have to understand fully to obey immediately. So, here's what happens. Verse 20, Elijah kind of puts his mantle around Elisha. And then in verse 20, what does Elisha do? The Bible says he left the oxen, ran after Elijah, and said, "Let me kiss my father and my mother, then I will follow you." And I just want to kind of point out, this is one of those immediate type of followings. You see it with the disciples when Jesus comes, and particularly Mark's gospel. He calls them immediately. They left everything and followed Jesus. And that's what happens here. Elisha doesn't have to pray about it. He doesn't have to do a list of pros and cons. Here's the reasons why I should. Here's the reasons why I shouldn't. He just says, "God, I believe you're in on this. And because I believe that, I'm going to step out in faith. I'm going to go and follow Elisha, because in doing that, I'll be following you." You don't have to understand fully to obey immediately. I'm not sure how this will speak to you, but I believe, you know, with all of my heart, that when we take on a posture of spiritual readiness, you can obey immediately, even when you don't understand fully. So, here's how God will lead you. God rarely gives us all the details in the 10-year strategic plan for how this is going to transform your life. And I believe God is often strategically vague in God's directions, because you want the details, but God many times will look at you or at me and say, "You know, you can't handle the details. If I showed you everything, you wouldn't show up. And so I'm just going to show you what it takes to take the next step." And so God many times will say this: "I want you to move in this direction. I want you to take a step of faith. And this is the direction I want you to move." And so what happens is that if we will step out of faith, we take that step, then God will show us a little bit more of the picture, kind of bring it into focus. And you take another step in faith, and God shows you a little bit more of God's plan for your life. And the more you step out and trust God, the more God begins to show you some of the details of where God is leading you. And many times God will lead you with just one word. And you see this over and over again in the Bible. You see God say to Moses or to Abraham, "Go. Go to the land that I will show you. Go." And so they step out in faith. Or in the New Testament, Peter sees Jesus walking on the water. And he's like, "Hey, that's crazy. Jesus is walking on water. Jesus, if it's you, tell me to come to you." And what does Jesus say? Jesus says, "Come." And Peter steps out of the boat and begins to walk on the water toward Jesus. Or it could be that sometimes you hear one word from God, and I don't know what it would be, but maybe if you're struggling in your marriage, the word that comes is God says, "Stay. Stay and work it out. All things are possible with God. I will bring healing to this relationship. Stay so you stay. Or some of you, maybe you have a health situation and you're really worried about it. You're facing a surgery or battling something you've been battling for a period of time. And maybe the word that God sends to you is trust. Trust that my healing touch will be upon your life and you obey. Or some of you, maybe you have an idea. Maybe it's an idea for a ministry or a new business or to write a book. And you're like, oh, I just don't know how or when and how are we going to pay for it? When could I do this? And what God may say to you is start. Start. I'm going to be with you from start to finish. But you take that step and start, and I will help you see it through. You don't have to understand immediately. Some of you, maybe you've been attending church for a long time, and you've kind of helped God a little bit at a distance, but you're intrigued. And you're like, I'm following Jesus. I love Jesus. And what Jesus might say to you is commit. Give me your whole heart. I will lead you. I will lead you into the future that I have for you. Commit. Or some of you maybe have been praying about the future of your family, and the Holy Spirit's begun to whisper to you the words adopt or foster. You're like, oh, you know, boy or girl or international or domestic, what age? I don't understand. And God says, no, step forward. I will bless you and your family and this child. You don't have to understand everything to take the first step. And some of you are going to hear this and you're going to think, well, I don't have all the details. And I don't know everything, but I'm going to still step out in faith and fully obey God. Now, so first thought, you don't have to understand fully to obey immediately. Here's the second thought for today. Those God uses the most are the ones who hold on to beliefs. Those God uses the most are the ones who hold on to beliefs. So we get to verse 21. So Elisha left him and went back. He took his yoke of oxen and slaughtered it. Now remember, these are the animals. This is his tractor here. You know, these are the animals that he uses to bring in his livelihood. And the fact that Elisha has these 12 oxen, once again, this is a big operation here. He's coming from a family of some amount of means. And what does the Bible say he does with the oxen? He slaughters them. He slaughters them. And then what's he do with the plows? He burned the plowing equipment to cook the meat and gave it to the people, and they eat. So I guess his grill or his smoker was broken, so he takes the plows, and he's going to, I don't know if it was brisket he was making that day, or if it was just steaks that he was just going to cook up quick, how would you like yours? Well, medium rare, okay, And so he calls the people together, and he feeds them, it's a feast, that's what it was. And then he set out to follow Elijah and became his servant. And it sounds kind of crazy. God's calling me to be a prophet. God's calling me to follow Elijah, to go and be like him, and maybe to do even greater things than him. So what do? Well, I kill the cattle and burn the plows, and that's what I do, and that just seems kind of crazy. And now you can see, in a sense, why he killed the cattle. I mean, many times when God would bless them, they would kill an animal and offer sacrifice to honor God and to say thank you. But man, burning the plows, it's as if he's saying, I'm burning plan B. There's only plan A. There's only obey God. There is no plan B. And I got to tell you, my daughter's only 3 and 5 years old. And, if they get old enough, they come, with a plan, and I'm kind of saying, follow your faith and everything, but let's hold on to plan B. Don't burn the plows just yet, right? Go give it your best effort, and then let's see what happens. But you get another story like this, though, in the New Testament. When you go into Scripture, there are often times when people are so moved to follow God that they do things that seem crazy to us. So remember Jesus encountered